Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Now, Pacific people are more likely than New Zealand Europeans to suffer from a traumatic brain injury, and that's according to an AUT University study, which shows it's happening in our homes, playgrounds and sports field. Now, the recent early retirement of All Blacks and Chiefs rugby player Ben Afiaki's highlighted just how serious an issue this is.
Ben Afiaki's no stranger to traumatic brain injury. Symptoms of the trauma have kept him off the rugby field for over a year.
It's normally headaches, and I had a lot of neck pain, and day-to-day activities like driving and watching TV, reading texts, pretty much everything that involves a screen or concentrating made me feel nauseous.
Afiaki's paid the ultimate price for his brain injury. He's had to call it a day on his rugby career, hanging up his boots earlier than expected.
And I knew the outcome if I was to get another one, and the severity of the symptoms I'd have, you know, with me maybe for the rest of my life, or even worse, you know.
Ben's retirement from rugby comes at a time when an AUT study on traumatic brain injury has shown that Pacific people are more prone to this kind of injury. 0 to 4-year-olds and 15 to 24-year-olds were found to have higher risk.
So for the children, we found a lot of the injuries were sustained through falls. So young children trying to get their balance. So things like tripping over in the house, falling off the sofa, as well as being out in the playground. When we had a look at the 15 to 25 year olds, males were at higher risk, and that generally seemed to be because of a higher engagement in sports activities. So things like motocross and rugby, for example.
AUT Pasifika academic Tangaloa Tele Peggy Fairbairn Dunlop is stoked that Pacifica communities have been specifically researched, but the results do raise questions.
I guess much of the publicity on this research so far has been looking at the football scene, but to me, if children in that underage, you know, that primary infant group are suffering these, what does it say about our parenting practices?
For Ben Afiaki, he's looked long and hard at what's best for him to avoid further brain injury.
Rugby's a great sport, but it is, you know, just a game, and I think the rest of my life's a lot more important.
And joining us today for our Talanoa is one of the authors of the study, Wesley Lagolago, and Dr. Monique Faleafa from Leva. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, we saw in the story just now with Ben, a lot of our young males are getting hurt through sports. But what about our young children? Why are there so many kids getting traumatic brain injuries?
Well, when we were looking at that through the study, it was basically the same thing about falls. Falls was the highest cause of injury to young children, and it's that vulnerability of children from 0 to 5. They're more likely to be not coordinated, and also their balance is still a bit off, and so parents are quite concerned, and so they'll take their kids to the doctors for that reason.
Okay, is there any other reason why are we falling more than other kids? Or is it less supervision, or
yeah,
what's happening here?
Well, obviously the homes are not kind of built up to be childproof at all, and so it's a matter of being aware of what the sort of risks there are around the home, which can cause children to fall over and hurt themselves.
And it's quite scary, isn't it? Because, you know, for these young kids to have something like a traumatic brain injury, this is something that's going to affect them for life. Monique, do these stats in the study surprise or alarm you?
It's not surprising. Across the general New Zealand population, those two age groups, young children and young adults, still sustain the highest rate of mild traumatic brain injury. So we're the same pattern as the general population, except it is quite alarming that we're higher incidence than the general population. So what could be happening is that with young people, we tend to underreport brain injury, but maybe as parents with children sustaining brain injury, we're finally reporting the rates at accurate levels now.
Okay, now we're seeing a lot of, repeat brain injuries as well. Is this to do with, our macho attitude, Wesley? Do you think people just sort of put up with it or don't realise how serious it is?
Well, exactly. I don't think people do think it's that serious at all. And it's more to do if my arm's not broken, I can still use it, sort of attitude. And so if it's the same with traumatic brain injuries, if they don't seek medical attention fast enough, that can cause long-term disabilities.
Monique, you're doing a lot of work with the NRL, with Levar. What kind of impact do you see it having, especially for our sports players, like a brain injury?
Well, every brain is different, so it's like a fingerprint. So a blow to the head for one player may cause no concussion and they keep playing, but the same blow at the same force for another player may actually be really life-threatening and lead to permanent damage. So the best prevention and the best strategies is just to make sure we put things in place to protect our brains. And one of the biggest ones that we know works well is a custom-made mouth guard.
Okay.
It's actually found more effective than headgear, and it protects the brain on impact because it reduces the blow, but it also slows down that bruising of the brain and tearing of the structures that allow the brain to move around in the skull.
Are our sports players using them as much as they should be, or I'm just wondering if this needs to be put in place more? Or?
Yeah, it's now mandatory across all rugby league and rugby union. They can't take the field without a mouth guard.
What other practical recommendations do you want to see to help protect or keep our young people safe?
I think prevention is the best strategy. Once you have a brain injury, we need parents on the sideline, managers, administrators, knowing how to spot it and then knowing what to do when it happens. So ACC has traumatic brain injury guidelines you can download off the web. And also just a quick concussion check. There's a sideline check, you can ask a few questions. But overall, the best policy is, if in doubt, leave them out.
Wesley, I'm wondering, does there need to be more of an attitude change in terms of, like we saw in the Mark Hunt story earlier, that he, you know, felt that he should, you know, take it like a man, and
yes,
what's he meant to do, get out of there? Is there that kind of general attitude amongst our young men in terms of
that's
injuries?
That's definitely the truth. I do feel that we do need a change of attitude and try and be a bit more aware of what will be affected in the future, as opposed to here and now, what this fight means to me, sort of thing. So,
and finally, Monique as well. In terms of attitudes, does there need to be a big shift for our community?
What I've seen work to change attitudes is change in regulatory policy. So rules changes in the game to slow down tackles, to protect the spine and the neck and the head in tackles. Wearing mouth guards is mandatory. That actually, what it does is it raises awareness of how dangerous the game is. And so people start going, oh, we better do something about this. So we need probably more rules in some of the full contact sports that we've had in the last few weeks.
Okay, because we don't want to stop our young people playing, so we want to keep everyone active.
That's
but just to be a bit more aware, thank you so much for joining us on the program today.
Thanks, Mama.
Well, and if you aren't playing sport this morning, be safe, do take it easy. Stay with us after the break. Inspiring rising Pacific stars, Sio Vailua's leading the way.
Pasifika kids are just naturally gifted. And so being able to sort of use that is basically like a vehicle to, being able to unlock other passion areas in their lives.